Hey guys, Weeby News here, and today I am doing a video discussing a few of my favorite Earth to Die theories, and these are a mixture of my own opinion and ones I found online, mostly on the Your Turn to Die subreddit, so huge shout out to the subreddit. Some of these theories are going to be loosely based off of what I've read on there, and some are going to be direct references to theories I found on there. I'm going to be linking any posts that inspired me or are directly referenced in the description, so I definitely recommend you guys look into those if you're really interested in theories like I am. And also, huge thanks to the user JamDudes for letting me use their Gin Mastermind art for the thumbnail. I bet some of you guys almost thought it was real too. It's that good. With that being said, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Please leave a like and a comment and subscribe and share the video if you enjoy it. I've worked really hard on this and I'm very proud of it, so I hope you guys enjoy it too. Also, there's gonna be spoilers for everything Your Turn to Die, including Your Turn to Shine and some of those endings, so just be aware of that before you continue the video. But yeah, without further ado, let's go ahead and get right into it. Now to begin, I want to focus on the obvious, absolute suspiciousness of our very lovely protagonist, Sarah Chitowin. It's heavily implied that the entire game revolves around Sarah. Kai states that although he's unaware of the Death Game's true goal, he's under the impression that it all revolves around her. Gashu refers to her as the Chosen One before his death, and Hayasaka, when he died in the first trial, cursed her name before his death. It's also notable that out of all the survival percentages, Sarah has the highest based on the simulations they executed, and Midori describes her in some of the simulations to be terrifying and having a stronger survival instinct than anyone else. That she was someone willing to kill others and to use their deaths as a way to manipulate the group. We even see a taste of this evil side in the Shinroot, where she manipulates Ranmaru into killing the others. We also see what appears to be a very sinister looking Sarah at the end of one of Mishima's Your Turn to Shine routes. In the scene, the Mishima AI realizes that something is wrong and that he's being watched. Next, it appears that the entire game was a simulation run by Asunaro to collect experimental data on the Death Game participants. Then someone who appears to be Sarah walks in and is asked about what they should do regarding the simulation, implying that she's in a position of power. She says to start it over again as many times as it takes, and she looks quite evil while doing so. Her undeniable involvement in the purpose of the Death Game, along with this scene, has led a lot of people to theorize that she might be the true mastermind behind the Death Game, and that either her memory was wiped, or that the Sarah that we're controlling is a doll. And although I used to think that she was a doll, I no longer do for a couple of reasons. As we all know from Rio Ranger's death, dolls don't bleed, and we've seen Sarah bleed in past CGs. Also, if you look at the bad endings for the Chapter 2 attractions, we see her, along with almost all the other living participants, bleed during the endings. The only exception are Reko and Shin. In all of their endings, there's either no blood at all, or we just see blood coming from Sarah. For Shin, I don't think it adds really any suspicion to him, since we do see him bleed later in the chapter. But with Reko, I believe it's very purposeful that we don't see her bleed, since we know that she switches out with a doll at one point during the chapter. And this to me confirms that not only Sarah, but all the other participants are human. Because of this, my assumption would be that the Sarah that we see at the end of Your Turn to Shine is actually the doll version of Sarah, and that it's implanted with memories from one of the games that Midori was talking about, where she was cruel and terrifying. We already know that the doll exists, and we've seen it, so I don't think it's too far of a stretch to assume that it might be the doll that we saw in the ending. Also, this theory will make a bit more sense later, but first I need to explain some stuff. In Chapter 2, Keiji describes the Hades incident to Sarah. It was a mutual death game meant to bring all crime rings together to form one monolith. Representatives from each ring battled together to decide who would reign at the top of criminal society. It being a death game makes it seem pretty similar to what the characters are participating in now. Not only this, but another thing that connects to the Hades incident is the memorandum that Sarah finds in the secret room. It's even titled That Incident, making it seem like it's possibly referring to the Hades incident, since they both use the same word. In the memorandum, it describes the events that took place during the Death Game. Many of the events sound very similar to what's happened in the Death Game currently taking place. It mentions Russian roulette and a charismatic 17-year-old high school girl whose best friend dies in the first victim conference. It eventually trails off from the current plotline, describing characters similar to Keiji and Gin as the victims in the second victim conference, which, as we all know, is not the case in this Death Game. And then it continues on with the narrator stating that they acquired a great admiration for her and wanted her to win the whole game, even if it meant his death. But in the third conference, she died, and now he's haunted by hallucinations of her and cannot love another woman. I believe that the memorandum is in fact describing the events that took place during the Hades incident, and that one of the purposes of this death game is to recreate that incident. More specifically, I believe they want to reenact this event in order to recreate a certain participant in it. This being the high school girl described in the memorandum, but this time I believe they want her to win. The writer mentions being so infatuated with her that they could never love again, so I think it makes sense that their obsession could lead to trying to recreate her. They mention being willing to die if it meant that she could succeed, so I think that they may believe that she was the rightful winner of the Hades incident, which is why they want to recreate the game and her as well. And this girl sounds a lot like Sarah, so I believe she is the attempted recreation of this girl, and I feel like this theory really falls into place when you think about how the death game seems to revolve so heavily around Sarah, like I mentioned previously. I believe this memorandum was likely written by the true mastermind of this game, and I also think that they are the current head of Asunaro, and that Asunaro is the criminal monolith created from the Hades incident. And finally, I believe that Mr. Chidowin, Sarah's stepfather, is this person. And there's a few reasons as to why I believe this. In his flashback with Kai, he acts very suspiciously. First, we learn that he's not her real father, which I'll expand on more in a bit. And secondly, he mentions that she has so much potential for change that he's put his life on the line for it. And finally, when Kai expresses his affection towards Sarah, her father erupts into a fit of rage. Initially, it could be seen like fatherly protection, but I think it also could be portraying that unhealthy obsession that we see from the writer of the memorandum. Also, at the end of chapter 2 in Kana's Route, we see some evidence that her father is aware of her participation in the death game and is quite glad that she's made it this far, which seems like something that the memorandum writer would be wanting to keep a close eye on, if my theory is correct. I also theorize that Mr. Chidowin is Meister and is keeping an eye on her during the game through that alias. As we can see in that scene with Sarah, their sprite poses are very similar, and although it is a small detail, the game has used sprites in order to reveal secrets before. For example, in Chapter 3, we learn that Mai has Midori's hands installed onto her because her sprites lack the gloves seen in her victim video. Also in Chapter 2, they use the discrepancy of the fake Reko sprite containing the glove that the real Reko lost as evidence to prove that she was a doll. Also, with him being the writer of the memorandum and her stepdad, I feel like it makes sense that he would want to be close with a potential successor early on, even before the game. And yes, I do know that he is super gross and creepy if this theory is true, but one possible hole in this theory is how would he know her potential from such a young age? Sarah's not even aware that he's her stepfather. Well, I believe that all the candidates were monitored and chosen at very young ages. It's already implied that they've been monitored for a very long time since the AI personalities of the candidates were last updated 2.5 years ago and are updated every 3 years. I speculate that all the candidates, not participants, just want to make that clear, so everybody besides Nao, Kugi, Joe, and Kai, at some point stayed at the Asunaro orphanage that Kyutara comes from. And in my opinion, I think that orphanage was created for this death game. Some evidence of this is that many of the candidates so far have been confirmed to have non-biological parents or to have been separated from their biological siblings at some point, such as Sarah, Kyutaro, Kana, and So. I speculate that at the orphanage, they ran tests on the children from an early age to determine their potential for succeeding the high school girl in the memorandum. Asunaro is a company that does medical research too, so I don't think it's too out of their reach to perform these types of tests on children, and I believe that Sarah, from even a very early age, had the highest success rate, which is why Mr. Chidowin became her stepfather early on. And yes, again, I know, very creepy. I will say the biggest hole in this theory that I've noticed is the fact that Kai was assigned to watch over Sarah as a spy at the Chidowin residence. This implies that no one there is connected to Asunaro, and her father even communicates with Kai through email, and it implies that he's aware of the killing game and wants to run away from it, likely with Sarah so she doesn't get involved. And my idea, if he still ends up being the mastermind, is that he strictly runs everything under the alias of Meister, or he's just one of those masterminds who runs everything from the shadows and no one in the company knows his true identity. Obviously though, this is just my speculation, so the hole still exists. I just wanted to point it out so you guys know that the theory isn't totally solid. But yeah, feel free to let me know what you guys think about this whole theory in the comment section below. I thought it was pretty interesting. I spent a lot of time researching for it, so I hope you guys enjoyed it. And another interesting thing that I feel ties along to this theory is one I found by So version 2.0 on Tumblr. The memorandum's author's position in the game seems to reflect Shin's role in the death game, or more specifically, I should say So Hiyori's role. Midori, aka the real So, was meant to participate in the death game before his death, slash when he became more of a doll than a human, and afterwards it seems like they decided to swap him out with Shin, but Shin has a very different personality from So. He's a very self-sacrificial person, so in order to make him turn into So Hiyori, Fiore and fit that role better, they showed him the winning percentages so that he would alter his personality to match the most terrifying person he knows. I just thought this idea was interesting and wanted to share it, since I always kind of felt like the idea of Midori participating in the death game would be really weird, but I feel like it makes a lot more sense to me if he was meant to fill the memorandum's author's previous role. So like I said, I think the purpose of this death game is to recreate the girl from the memorandum and for her to win this time. I also think that the ending of this death game will likely determine the new head of Asunaro, similar to the prize for winning the Hades incident. I think the mastermind is the current head of Asunaro and wants to recreate the high school girl so that she can become the new leader, since I think he likely believes that she was the one who should have won the Hades incident. Now, this brings me back to my theory regarding the Sarah at the end of Your Turn to Shine and her being a doll. The first thing that this made me ask was, why would they need a human Sarah and put so much time into grooming her to be the next heir to Asunaro if the doll version is so capable? Well, from what we've seen, a big part of the game is comparing dolls to humans. During the subgame, the participants are forced to determine who is real and who is a doll, and later they're put in a position to decide if the doll's lives are equally valuable or not. They seem to constantly be trying to improve the dolls and to make them more and more human. Gashu, for example, instilled a Rio Ranger with intense jealousy of humans because he felt that negative emotions were what truly made humans, well, human. So I think this death game isn't just to recreate the high school girl or to groom her to become the leader of Asunaro, but is also meant to determine whether or not dolls or humans are superior. I think that at the end of this game, we may see Sarah go up against her doll as a way to determine this. But this is just my theory on everything. Obviously, I'm not dead set on all of this. A lot of this is just kind of like my speculation and things I've kind of come up with to explain some of the suspicious stuff that's happened in the game. So let me know what you guys think about my ideas and if you agree or disagree with them. Next, I want to dive into discussing the most wholesome character in the game and how suspicious he is. Funnily enough, there's a pretty popular theory about Gin being the mastermind or working for Asunaro, which is why I made him the thumbnail. I don't personally believe it myself, but I do want to describe it to you guys a bit, since it's still a fun theory to discuss in my opinion. The main reasons why people suspect him are because we've yet to see Gin's collar, and the other characters made such a big deal about confirming that Shin had a collar. And there's also the mystery of Mishima's head. Even the floor masters have admitted that they don't know its whereabouts. So I've seen a lot of people speculate that it could be in Mu-chan. Disturbing, I know. Finally, people are suspicious of him because he snuck into the first floor and because he was able to find the secret passage before anybody else. There's also the fact that we still have no idea what he was doing down there. There's some big contradictions to this theory though, which is why I don't really believe it. And I think there's another theory that kind of explains his suspicious behavior better. The first contradiction is that although we've never seen his collar, he, like Hayasaka, was pulled up to the magnetic ceiling of the locker room by his neck, this implying that he was pulled up by his collar. And I've seen some people try to say that he was pulled up because he's holding Mishima's collar inside of Mu-chan, but he would have been pulled up by Mu-chan, not by his neck. And the only explanation would be him putting on Mishima's collar before entering the locker room, but that just seems like a stretch since there's no reason for him to put himself in danger to prove his innocence since no one suspects him. That's just my opinion on it. But this still leaves how mysterious it is that he found the passageway to the first floor and how he managed to avoid getting caught by Miley. A theory that attempts to explain this is that he may have a secret connection to Miley. More specifically, many speculate that she could be Gin's mother. Some of the surface reasons as to why people believe this is because they both do look similar, and the ages for the most part do add up. Miley is 30 years old while Gin is 12, and this means that she would have been pregnant with him at around 18 years old, which although is very young to have a child, it's not totally impossible. Gin has talked very highly of his mother, and she seems to be a very important person in his life, so important that he used his Asunaro wish for her to have a long, healthy life. But we have yet to see her in the game, and granted there is some sketch art of her by Nankadai, the creator of Your Turn to Die, which shows her with Gin, but it doesn't show her face at all, so it really doesn't confirm what she looks like. And even though we've never seen her face in the game or otherwise, she seems to be a very important character, especially since Midori tells Gin, when referring to his wish, that his mom is healthy and looking after him just as he wished. This almost makes it sound like she's watching the death game, and it would make a lot of sense if she was a floor master. In chapter 3, we learn about Miley's past before she became a floor master, and how Asunaro may have convinced her to join the death game. Her original name was Imre Harai, and in the report they mentioned that she was satisfied with her life because there was a man that she was considering marrying. So they may need to drive her beloved mad in order to get her to cooperate. This could support the theory as well, since we learn that Gin's stepfather is an alcoholic. Another aspect of Miley's character that I believe also can support this theory is that Miley has acted suspiciously against Asunaro's wishes a few times in the game, which makes me think she's not truly loyal to them. She also has a pretty big motivation position to work against them, considering what they likely did to her lover. Firstly, when Keiji and Sarah snuck down to the first floor, they overhear her having a conversation with somebody else involved in the death game. In this conversation, she states the importance of Rearranger's chip and how it can destroy the place's entire security. This alarms the other person that she's talking to, and they tell her to be quiet in case somebody's listening in. And in response, she says if that's the case, then things would get quite fun, almost implying that she's aware that participants are listening in. Now, if this only happened once, I think it could be chalked up to a coincidence, but there are several other cases of her indirectly helping the participants. Before the second main game, she gives the group a huge hint where she accuses Gashu of transgressing against the rules. This becomes a very important part of the discussion and almost leads to a retrial because of the rules, and this would not have been possible without her comments beforehand. She also gave Sarah the four papers containing the winning percentages before the final attraction, and when Gashu notices this, he gets very upset, implying that it was also against their wishes. This theory would explain Gin's suspicious behavior in Chapter 2 when he accesses the first floor, since if Miley is his mother and is secretly against Asunaro, then she could have been the one to tell him about the secret passageway, and if there is a connection there, it makes sense that he'd be able to travel safely through her floor. There are some potential holes with this theory though. Firstly, we know both Miley's full human name and Gin's full name, and the last names aren't the same. An easy explanation for this could be that Ibushi is his stepfather's last name. Not all kids are willing to take their last name, but I think it's likely that Gin did, since his parents got married when he was only 2 years old. Of course, this is just my speculation though, I just thought I'd point it out. Next, there's no reaction from Gin in Chapter 1 when Miley introduces herself. You'd think that he would like faint or yell out mom or react somewhat, but it doesn't really seem like he recognizes her at all. Another potential explanation for this could be what happened during Gin's first trial. Gin is one of the few characters that we know nothing about their first trial, so maybe similar to So's, Miley shows up, except this time she explains the situation to him, tells him to act as if he doesn't know her, so that she can destroy the game from the inside or something along those lines. This, of course, is just my speculation though. I sort of like halfway believe this theory. I mean, like, how could this come from this? But overall, I do find it really interesting nonetheless, and I do think it's more likely than the Gin being the mastermind theory. The next theory I'd like to talk about is not my own. It's just one that I found on Reddit and I thought was really cool. The theory is that the policeman, aka Keiji's hero, and the one that he ends up killing is actually Joe's dad. The post I found out about this were by the user Bierzels and Nishiki Enjoyer. Of course, there are some surface level reasons to believe this, like their personalities, clothing style, and looks are pretty similar. It's notable that their eye color is the same, and even their eye shape is also very similar. But of course, there are a lot more reasons why people believe this. One is that the police officer's name has never been revealed. One time, some dialogue was even just straight up cut out right before his name was said, and it almost seems like his name may have some importance to it, which is why they haven't revealed it yet. And Joe also has an interesting reaction to Keiji when he reveals that he's a cop. He seems surprised and then condemns himself for being wary of him. Also, when Gin mentions his alcoholic father, Joe gets really quiet and changes the subject, implying that it might be a soft spot for him. And as we know through Keiji's flashbacks, Mr. Policeman became a dad at some point, and not only this, but he mentions at one point that he wants his son to have a manly name. According to the wiki, the Japanese version contains a pun implying that Joe is his son. And in the past, Nankadai explained that Joe's name is derived from the line Stand Up Joe, which is from a manly, passionate boxing manga, Shida no Joe. It's also notable that Joe's kanji could come from this, which according to Jisho means hero slash manly person. They also point out that Midori says that Joe was brought into the game as an equalizer to make Sarah weaker. However, if you think about it, every one of those who wasn't on that list was directly associated with somebody else in some capacity. Now to Mishima and Kugi to Kana. But if you consider that Joe relates to Sarah, there ends up being a problem with this. Who does Kai connect to? Theory of Joe being the policeman's dad presents an elegant solution for this, since it could mean that the equalizer for Sarah isn't actually Joe, but is Kai, and that Joe came to the game as an equalizer for Keiji instead. Lastly, in a livestream that Nankadai did, it contained art that showed Joe in a police uniform. The final theory I'd like to cover is that Kai may still be alive. This is another theory that isn't by me, it's just one I found on Reddit that I thought was really interesting. And this one is by the user Mellow is Cool. I'm going to be going through what I believe are the most convincing arguments that they had for this theory. Based on the way he's bleeding, it seems like the way he cut his wrists in order to avoid execution isn't fatal. Likely, in his quote-unquote death scene, he just passed out from blood loss. And since he's an assassin, someone who literally specializes in killing, it seems likely that he knew this would be the case. And if you add in the theory of Miley secretly working against Asunaro from the evidence I provided earlier, it's possible she was able to help him after he passed out, and that he's the one on the IV in the back part of her office. Next, they point out that for every other character that's died, it's stated in the text box that they expired. But for Kai, nothing of the sort was stated. There's also that conversation with Joe where there was no audio. They speculate that at least one of them should be alive so that we can eventually learn what the conversation was about, and that they think that person is Kai. And they also point out that his hand in this photo is too tense for it to belong to somebody who's dead, and that it can't be rigor mortis, which is the stiffening of joints and muscles of a body a few hours after death, since it only occurs hours after death. Finally, there's the mystery as to how the laptop ended up in the room of Rubble. They state that the third floor was locked before the first trial, so it would have been moved there after. I do slightly disagree with this point though, since there is a pretty good chance that Kai was aware of the secret passage and used it to put the laptop in the room of Rubble before the third floor was opened up, but he could have also done it after faking his death too, so I just wanted to include it here. Also, there's the mystery of how Shin found the charger. They speculate that maybe Kai put it somewhere where he felt that Shin would eventually stumble upon it. But anyways, this will conclude the video. I really hope you guys enjoyed. Like I said before, I worked really hard on this video and it was super duper fun, and I really hope that you guys enjoy it too. Feel free to let me know if you agree or disagree with my theories, or if you have any of your own that I didn't mention in this video. I'm definitely curious to hear what you guys think. I love theory videos. They're like my favorites to make. So yeah, I would definitely love to make more for Yurchin to Die or other series if you guys are interested. But yeah, once again, thanks guys for watching the video. Please leave a like and comment and subscribe if you did enjoy it, and I will see you guys real soon.